السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، صلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. ثم أما بعد، welcome back. This is the first session إن شاء الله تعالى from سورة النازعات. So we're done with سورة النبأ، سورة عما يتساءلون. And today إن شاء الله تعالى we start with سورة النازعات، سورة which is the second سورة in جزء عما. And it is number 79 in the order of the مصحف. It's a surah number 79. In the order of the Mus'haf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالنَّازِعَاتِ غَرْقَى وَالنَّازِعَاتِ غَرْقَى. Now, in terms of the name of the surah, in the Arabic language, it was pronounced as Surat al-Nazi'at. Surat al-Nazi'at. Some of the mufassirin, they call it Surat wal-Nazi'at. The reason they say al-Nazi'at without anything with it, because al-Nazi'at is the only time it was mentioned in the Quran is in Surat al-Nazi'at. So there is, you know, some surahs, they have multiple names, but An-Nazi'at is one of those few surahs that has basically one particular name because it's very unique to it. So An-Nazi'at. And what's the meaning of An-Nazi'at anyway? When it comes to Surah An-Nazi'at, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the beginning of the surah, that's not the theme of the surah itself. The surah itself is Surah Makkiyah. It's surah that was revealed in the Meccan period. And if you guys remember when we said the Meccan era or the Meccan period, what is the main message of the Meccan Quran? What is it? Aqeedah, the establishment of faith. And when you establish faith in that era, that period of time, there were two major areas that the Quran covers. Two major areas of aqeedah and establishment of faith that is usually covered. What are these two areas? Tawheed, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which includes speaking about Allah azza wa jal, about His worship, about His beautiful names and attributes and so on, and also speaking about the akhirah. The afterlife, which includes the signs of the Day of Judgment, the events of the Day of Judgment, and the afterlife events and so on. So these are the two major themes that cover most of the surah, of course, of the Makki era. Surah An-Nazi'at is one of these surah that will cover the exact same subject. However, of course, as you know from the previous surah, there are five different topics covered in Surah An-Naba. Surah An-Nazi'at, similarly, it has different topics as well. We're going to move on to one topic after the other, inshallah ta'ala. Beginning with Al-Qasam, which means an oath, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swearing by certain things here at the beginning of the surah. So recite a particular part of the surah itself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالنَّازِعَاتِ غَرْقَى وَالنَّاشِطَاتِ نَشْطًا وَالسَّابِحَاتِ سَبْحًا فَالسَّابِقَاتِ سَبْقًا فالمدبرات أمرا يوم ترجف الراجفة تتبعها الرادفة قلوب يومئذ واجفة أبصارها خاشعة يقولون أئنا لمردودون في الحافرة أئذا كنا عظاما نخرة قالوا تلك إذا كرة خاسرة فإنما هي زجرة واحدة فإذا هم بالساهرة. So what are these surahs, what does these ayat mean? First of all, the first part of the surah starts with Al-Qasam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swears by certain things. In Surah Amma Yatasa'alun, the beginning of the surah wasn't about Qasam. There was nothing like Allah swearing by something or establishing an oath at the beginning of the surah. It was Amma Yatasa'alun. The brilliant commencement of the surah was with a question. Here's another style of the Quran with a brilliant commencement. Brilliant commencement, basically the arresting anecdotes and the attention grabber that is mentioned in the surah is what came in the form of Qasam. You know, once you meet someone and there is no conversation that starts yet, and the moment they meet you, what do they tell you? Say, I swear to you, and I swear by Allah, and I swear by this, and I swear by that. When they start counting, you know, swearing by something before they even tell you anything, what is the natural reaction that comes to your mind when you meet somebody and right away they start swearing in front of you and giving oaths for Allah, about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with Allah azza wa jal's name and so on? What comes to your mind at the beginning? First of all, it's a serious matter, right? Like, whoa, what's going on? Hold on a second. Whoa, what is it? What's happening? So now, he grabbed your attention, right? This person grabs your attention right away. So it is a serious matter. Also, when someone says, I swear to you by this one time, and then a second time, a third time, fourth time, fifth time, like in this surah. The beginning of the surah, the first five ayat, they're all Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swearing by something. I swear to you by so-and-so. And I swear to you by so-and-so. Five times. So not just one, not just twice, not just thrice, more than four times. So five times the surah began with qasam. What does that tell you about what is coming next? That's very important. It's very, very significant. So it starts with qasam to grab your attention right away, because now you realize, oh, so this is a very serious matter. And then when it's not just once or twice, it's five times. That means it's extremely, extremely significant. It's extremely, extremely important. That's what it means. So therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala began with al-qasam five times. Now what we need to understand and we need to know is, what is it exactly that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala he swore by at the beginning of Surah An-Nazi'at that indicates the importance of what he is going to be talking about, what subject Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be explaining. Let's see that. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالنَّازِعَاتِ غَرْقَى وَالنَّاشِطَاتِ نَشْطَى. So we have وَالنَّازِعَاتِ غَرْقَى, we have وَالنَّاشِطَاتِ نَشْطَى, وَالسَّابِحَاتِ سَبْحَى, فَالسَّابِقَاتِ سَبْقَى, فَالْمُدَبِّرَاتِ أَمْرَى. Without even understanding Arabic, or without even looking at the translation, what do you hear over here? وَالنَّازِعَاتِ غَرْقَى وَالنَّاشِطَاتِ نَشْطَى وَالسَّابِحَاتِ سَبْحَى فَالسَّابِقَاتِ سَبْقَى فَالْمُدَبِّرَاتِ أَمْرَى. What is it that you're hearing right now? Forget about the meanings. Just the hearing, the sound of what is it? This is not rhythm. It has a certain rhythm. These are rhyming words, right? وَالنَّازِعَاتِ غَرْقَى وَالنَّاشِطَاتِ نَشْطَى وَالسَّابِحَاتِ سَبْحَى. Even if you don't understand Arabic language, even if you don't understand Arabic language, what do you see the pattern over here? نَازِعَاتِ غَرْقَى نَاشِطَاتِ نَشْطَى سَابِحَاتِ سَبْحَى سَابِقَاتِ سَبْقَى مُدَبِّرَاتِ أَمْرَى. What do you see over here? The pattern is the same, and then it's repetition of the same words here. نَاشِطَاتِ نَشْطَى سَابِحَاتِ سَبْحَى سَابِقَاتِ سَبْقَى. Yes, we have difference between نَازِعَاتِ غَرْقَى and مُدَبِّرَاتِ أَمْرَى. We're going to come to this later, inshallah. But as you can see, even the style itself is a rhyming style. And that adds to the beauty of listening to the recitation of the Quran itself. So there is a reason behind this beauty, of course, of the recitation. So now you have the style is amazing, the beginning is so shocking, and it's very surprising, and now it must be something very significant. What is it? Also, the style itself, وَالنَّازِعَاتِ غَرْقَى وَالنَّاشِطَاتِ نَشْطَى وَالسَّابِحَاتِ سَبْحَى. Sabha. This is in the Quran, this is in the Arabic language or the grammar of the Arabic words. This is jama. This is considered jama, which means plural. When we say nazi'at, nazi'at, the ending the word with an alif ta, in most cases, this is considered jama, plural. So this is plural. But that plural, is that a masculine plural or feminine plural? In the Arabic language, ending with an alif ta, usually in the plural, is actually considered a feminine plural. Here, when Allah says, وَالنَّازِعَاتِ غَرْقَى وَالنَّاشِطَاتِ نَشْطَى, it is also, all of it is in the feminine style. However, the feminine style of jama' or plural does not necessarily indicate any gender. Because in the Arabic language, sometimes when you talk about jama' taksir, basically, or when you talk about objects of different kind and groups, speaking about the groups, you refer to them in the same format. So here, although, as we're going to explain, the ayat talks about perhaps angels, it might be talking about horses, might be talking about for suns and nights, might be talking about the planets and the stars. So all of these different groups. So when we talk about groups in the Arabic language, we refer to them with an alif ta. Although we know the angels, you can't refer to them with gender. You can't say that they're male or female, right? But still, when they were mentioned over here, we mentioned in that style of plural because the focus is on the groups, the different groups of angels. The different groups of angels. That is the focus over here. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالنَّازِعَاتِ غَرْقَى. Just a quick question. Where's Umar? Is Umar here? My son. Okay. Can you check on him? JazakAllah khair. I want him to be on live TV, actually. Okay. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, والنازعات غرقا. What's the meaning of النازعات؟ النازعات. النازعات comes from the word from النزع. النزع. And what is النزع؟ Who knows the Arabic language? What's the meaning of النزع؟ النزع in the Arabic language, when you pull something out forcefully. When you pull something forcefully, ينزع. Like for example, if you have something in your hand and someone snatches this out from your hand. So this is basically نزعه من يده. He didn't take it only. No, نزع. So النزع is taking something forcefully. That's why the ayah began with والنازعات غرقا, by those who pull out. It says pull out, but it's actually it's more just pulling out. نزع, forcefully pulling this something out. But what is it they pull out anyway? They pull out the souls. The souls of whom? Of the people in general, all of them. والنازعات غرقا. But here, since it was mentioned forcefully, would that be the soul of the believer or disbeliever? The disbelievers. Because in the hadith of Hadith al-Bara ibn Azib, the Prophet ﷺ spoke about how the angels, they pull out the souls of the believers. How do they pull it out? By calling it out. يَا أَيَّتُ النَّفْسُ الْمُطْمَئِنَّةِ Oh, come out. So the believer comes out easy. The Prophet ﷺ described that like the water as it comes down from the cup or from the pot. So when you just spill the water, it just goes easy. And easy without any troubles. Similarly, the soul of the believer. As for the soul of the disbelievers, it will be pulled out. And as the angels try to pull out the soul of the disbelievers, what happened? It panics. So it just goes, the spirit starts getting divided and goes all over the body, but they will pull it out forcefully. So that's when النازعات came over here. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swearing by the angels who are going after these people. Basically, they're pulling their souls out. When the time comes for them to leave this world and to die, the angels will come and pull their souls out. Whether they like it or not, it's going to be pulled out forcefully. Allah says, غرقا. النازعات غرقا. غرقا in the Arabic language, الغرق in the Arabic language, is when something is completely in depth. It's kind of like you when you're immersed in something, that you're going to just go to the details of everything and goes all the way to be saturated with everything. Al-gharaq. And that's why when someone, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect you and guard you all, if someone drowns, what do they call this in the Arabic language? Ghariqa, yaghraq. Why? Because the water kind of completely, you know, covering and taking over everything. Also, when someone is in deep thinking, in the Arabic language, deep thinking, what do they call this person? What do they call the expression in the Arabic language about this person is? إغراقٌ في التفكير. مغرقٌ في التفكير. This person is in deep thoughts right now. Which means the word غرق or إغراق, it means the depth of it. So والنازعات غرقا, that means these angels, they pull out the souls of disbelievers with great, not violence in this regard, الغرق, it's basically to the details, to every single bit of it, every single pixel of the picture. You can imagine it right now. It just goes after the soul and pulls it out forcefully. وَالنَّازِعَاتِ غَرْقَ. Now, the question is, why starting with this? What do you guys think? Why would the surah begin with an image like this? Scary. Huh? Scary. It's something scary, but why do we have to start like this? Yes, Zakaria. Sorry, go ahead. It wants to show them an image about what's going to happen on the Day of Judgment. But remember, they're dying. They're still in this world. So what does it mean to start with a surah like that, the surah with this ayah? It's part of the attention, part of grabbing their attention. But now we're going into a different level of attention. What is that? Warning. Warning them. Why warning them with this in particular? Because the ayah speaks to whom? People in Mecca, the people in Mecca, they deny the afterlife. They don't believe that people will be returned back to life and they will be meeting the Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the ayah, it's suitable to begin with this threat. With this threat, it says, you know what? وَالنَّازِعَاتِ I swear to you by these angels which are going to come after you one by one and pulling your souls out forcefully, whether you like it or not. I swear by these angels. So imagine, they're denying the Prophet ﷺ. When the Prophet is inviting to Allah Azza wa Jal, they keep denying and mocking him about this issue of the Akhirah. And here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala defending the Prophet ﷺ, beginning a surah to be basically delivered to these people by such a great level of threat, that I swear to you by these angels who will come to take your souls forcefully, whether you like it or not. That's the first thing. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالنَّاشِطَاتِ نَشْطَى. النَّاشِطَاتِ. So when we say nashitat, what's the meaning of nashitat? In the Arabic language, if you hear the word nashit or nashit or nashit, what does it mean? Huh? Active. It means active. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now is swearing by these angels one more time. Nashitati, I swear to you by these active angels. Nashitati, nashta. In the Arabic language, when you repeat the word twice, nashitati nashta, like a masdar over here. Nashitati nashta. I swear to you by those angels who are very active in fulfilling their duties. That's what it means. So these angels who are pulling the souls of disbelievers, they don't take a break. That's what it means. Means they're gonna go after you one by one, speaking to the people of Mecca at that time. Gonna come after you one by one. They're always active and they don't take a break. If you take a break, that's what it means. Which means it's a threat for them. What does it mean exactly? The threat for the people of Mecca. What does that mean to them? If they're active working on this, what does it mean to them? It means you could be next. That means you could be next. If they're actively going and fulfilling the command of Allah of fulfilling the souls of these disbelievers, means you could be next because they don't stop doing their job. وَالنَّاشِطَاتِ نَشْطَى. And then Allah said, وَالسَّابِحَاتِ سَبْحَى. السابحات. In the word سَبِحَ يَسْبَحُ, what does it come to your mind when you say سَبِحَ يَسْبَحُ سِبَاحَةً in the Arabic language? Swimming. And what's the essence of swimming? When you swim in the water, right? Do you swim in the bottom of the water or swim at the top of the water? You swim actually on top. Down there it's called غَوْس in the Arabic language. On the top it's called سِبَاحَة. And when you do swimming on the surface of the water, just basically gracefully, swimming gracefully. And in the Arabic language, swimming was also was taken to express something outside the water. Anything that comes like gliding gracefully in the air has the exact same meaning of sibaha. That's why in the Arabic language, whenever they want to describe horses, when they describe horses that is actually running so fast, when the horse is running so fast, what does it do? It starts basically bouncing off the ground and gracefully gliding almost as it jumps from one, level to the other one, from one step to the other one. So all hoofs will be above the ground. This is called sabh in the Arabic language. It's like gliding. So that's an expression for the angels as well. So the angels, they're doing that and they're gliding. And when you see something that is gliding up there gracefully, it means it's very fast, that's what it means. Very fast, and it's going gracefully, it means no interruptions, and everything is perfect. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, and I swear to you, by these angels who will be swimming along with you, it's going to be gliding and going from one place to the other. They don't get any fatigue. They don't get tired, they're exhausted. Because when you glide in the air, are you using your energy? You're not. You're only using the air, right? And it's pushing you. So when Allah basically speak about the angel that they're also like they're gliding, means they don't get tired, they don't get any fatigue. That means they're going to always be active. And sabhan over here, speaking about sabhan after expressing nashat, their activity, it's very suitable over here. Why is that? Because sabhan, that means they don't get tired of being extremely active doing what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands them to do. So they have now the three levels over here. Then comes next, فَالسَّابِقَاتِ سَبْقَى. فَالسَّابِقَاتِ سَبْقَى. First of all, why did we have at the beginning of the surah, وَالنَّازِعَاتِ, I swear to you by these angels who will be going, pulling out the souls of disbelievers, and I swear to you by the angels who are always active in fulfilling that duty, and I swear to you by these angels who will be just like gliding, and they will be just gracefully going from one place to the other by the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not feeling tired or fatigue at all. I swear to you. And then comes what? فَالسَّابِقَاتِ سَبْقَى. فَالسَّابِقَاتِ سَبْقَى. Why do we start with wa, 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 and then there is fa afterwards? There are two meanings for this. Some of the ulama, They say that the waw, the fa following the waws, that means the group that come after the fa speaks about different category from the previous one. So if the first three, were about angels, then the second two will be about something else. It could be about something else. It could be about, like we said earlier at the beginning of the discussion here, could be speaking about the planets, could be speaking about the horses, could be speaking about the warriors, whatever that speaks about, different topics. Other Mufassirin, they say no. That actually it means here, the topic is still, the category is still the same, which means the angels. However, now the second two ayat over here from this list will be a consequences of the first three. Meaning after the first three, then that the, what is coming after the fa is coming in that order. It means here, they don't necessarily come in the same order. Because they can be gliding actively and then go and pull the soul of a disbeliever. Or they pull a disbeliever's soul and then actively keep gliding from one place to the other. So the activity over here is not necessarily in the same order. Because the waw in the Arabic language does not necessarily, you know, keep things in the same order. But if you have fa, once you have a letter, fa, article, fa over here, that means this comes after these events. So what are these two events that would come after the previous ones? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَالسَّابِقَاتِ سَبْقَى فَالسَّابِقَاتِ سَبْقَى فَالْمُدَبِّرَاتِ أَمْرًا. As for السابقات, comes from the Arabic language, سَبَقَ يَسْبِقُ or سِبَاق. So what is سِبَاق in the Arabic language? Race. Sibaq means race. Now in the context of the angels who are doing this, what do they exactly do then? What do they race about? What do they race for what? To fulfill the Lord's command, which means to take what? The soul of disbelievers. And as a matter of fact, in Hadith al-Bara' ibn Azib, about the journey of the soul, whether it's the soul of the believer or the soul of disbelievers, the Prophet ﷺ says, the angel of death comes and he takes the soul of the disbelievers, or he calls the soul of the believer and to come out. The moment he pulls that soul out, the moment he takes that soul out, immediately, the angels of Jannah, the angels of Rahmah, mercy, or the angels of torment and adab, they will be waiting at distance, away from him, from that angel, and then they will race. They will take that soul and they will race up to deliver that to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and then come back again. So the angels, after pulling the soul, then they race up to deliver that. فَالسَّابِقَاتِ سَبْقَى. All of this is still in warnings of the disbelievers about what's coming to them if they don't believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَالسَّابِقَاتِ سَبْقَى. Again, سَبْقَى, to confirm that. And finally comes فَالْمُدَبِّرَاتِ أَمْرَى. فَالْمُدَبِّرَاتِ أَمْرَى, speaking about the angels al-mudabbirat, that means the angels who arrange to do the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yudabbir in the Arabic language, at-tadbir in the Arabic language, is when you organize and when you make the effort to do something. So you're always plotting, you're always planning, you're always arranging to do something. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaking about these angels, that they're doing what? They're always busy fulfilling the plans of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and answer the commands of Allah azza wa jal. فَالْمُدَبِّرَاتِ أَمْرَى. What is أَمْرَى over here? The commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What commands are we talking about over here? What do you think? What kind of commands are these? Are these just the commands to pull the souls of the disbelievers and the believers, or talk about all the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Now the ayah concluded with this general topic, that they fulfill all the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Pulling the souls of the disbelievers, as it was described in this list of ayat, is just one of these duties of the angels. Just one of them. Now all of this came for what? As a threat, came as warning, came as an attention grabber for the disbelievers, the people of Mecca who deny the day of judgment. And just like you said, you heard it from the beginning. You're talking to somebody and immediately they begin with what? Warning you. I swear to you by these angels who will come to pull your soul forcefully, whether you like it or not. And I swear to you by these angels who are always actively moving from one task to the other one. And I swear to you, by these angels who will be gliding to fulfill these commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they don't take a break, they don't need rest because they don't feel fatigued or tired at all. And I swear to you, by these angels who are going to take these souls and raise to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to deliver that soul. Whether you accept that or not, whether you believe that or not, it's going to happen. And I swear to you by these angels who are actively fulfilling the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And not just this, they also fulfill all the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So all of this now the beginning. So now the attention of the people has been, of course, you know, been solicited. They're already paying attention to it. They already been listening. And now they might be scared because they want to know, okay, so what is this all about? Then comes the answer for what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has been swearing here in the surah. Allah Azza wa Jalla now is giving to us what we call in the Arabic language, Jawab al-Qasam. This is the answer to all these oaths right now. Naturally, when someone starts with an oath, then comes Jawab al-Qasam. The answer to this. If someone says to you, listen, the moment you come into the house, then you hear someone telling you, I swear to you by Allah Azza wa Jalla, and I swear to you by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, I swear to you again. And you're just like you're getting scared right now. What is it? What did I do wrong? So you need to know what. This is what you're looking for. What if the person swears to you by all, you know, the important things? Swears by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by the attributes of Allah azza wa jal, and then gives you no answer. How do you feel about it? Has that been fulfilled? That qasam has been fulfilled? No, because, okay, just bluffing right now. If you're just telling me all of this, I swear to you, but then you're not telling me anything. What did I do wrong? What happened? What are you swearing for? You're not telling me anything. That means it's just bluffing right now. That's why in the Arabic language, al-qasam always requests, always solicits actually jawab, that you need to have jawab over here and answer to this. So to show what is exactly that we're swearing for and swearing about. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَوْمَ تَرْجُفُ الرَّاجِفَةَ تَتْبَعُهَا الرَّادِفَةَ قلوب يومئذ واجفة أبصارها خاشعة يقولون أئنا لمردودون في الحافرة. To the end of this. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says over here, the jawab al-qasam is يوم ترجف الراجفة. The day, on the day, which means ترجف الراجفة, on the day, on that day, يوم, on that day when the first blowing of the trumpet, الصور, is blown, ترجف الراجفة. تتبعها الرادفة, the second blowing of the trumpet will follow. Then what happens? So what do we understand from this? Allah says, I swear to you by the angels that on the day when the angel will blow in the trumpet and the second blow will happen. So, is it complete? Is the concept complete right now? Not yet. So there is something missing. What is that? What does it mean when these things happen? Sometimes, part of Jawab al-Qasam is not mentioned. It's not mentioned, you know, verbally in the context of actually in the actual statement. Why? But there's an indication to it was mentioned. If the indication to it was mentioned, that means it was left for you to imagine it. What is it? So what do you think that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is referring to when he was talking about first blow on the trumpet and the second blow on the trumpet? What is it then? Huh? Everything will be destroyed. Okay, and then what?
Resurrection.
Because that's what they deny. They deny the end of this world, and they deny what? They return back to this life. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now, he's saying basically, if you would like to add a word in the Arabic language, as a meaning, as a reference to these two words, will be latub'athunna. Which means you shall definitely be resurrected. You shall definitely be brought back. That's what it means. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is swearing by the angels, as we described. Their activity, they're always, you know, doing their job, and they never feel fatigued or tired. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned details, and then he says, I swear to you by all of this, that you shall be resurrected. When is that? When the first blow takes place, and then the second one comes after that. So Allah Azza wa Jalla here now, answering them, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answering their claim that there's no such thing as a day of judgment or a day of resurrection. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answering this in this fashion. He says, يَوْمَ تَرْجُفُ الرَّاجِفَ. What are these two events that Allah mentioned over here? يَوْمَ تَرْجُفُ الرَّاجِفَ. In the Arabic language, saying, يَوْمَ تَرْجُفُ الرَّاجِفَ. On the day when a rajifa, tarjufu al-rajifa. So what do you understand from tarjufu al-rajifa? These two words are related, right? Because they sound the same. Tarjufu al-rajifa. So tarjufu in the Arabic language, tarjuf means to shake. So Allah says, يَوْمَ تَرْجُفُ الرَّاجِفَ. Here, when a rajifa starts shaking. So what is that a rajifa? The one that shakes starts shaking. When the thing that shakes starts shaking. What is that thing that shakes a jama'ah on that day? Earthquakes. This is a reference to what? To the earth. يَوْمَ تَرْجُفُ الرَّاجِفَ. Even though in the translation it says the trumpet is going to be blown into, but it wasn't mentioned in the Quran over here. In the Arabic text over here, did not mention the trumpet at all, as-sur. Mentioned a sequence. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives the command for the angel to blow in the trumpet, what's going to happen? Tarjufu al-rajifa. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned other ayat in the Quran as well, إِذَا رُجَّتِ الْأَرْضُ رَجَّى. When the earth is going to be taruj, and raj means to be shaken severely. So that means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaking over here about an event that will happen as a result of what? Of the command to blow on the trumpet. The earth is going to start shaking and shaking and shaking. إِذَا رُجَّتِ الْأَرْضُ رَجَّى, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. So the earth is going to start be shaken severely. So what happens when the earth shakes, Jama'ah? What happens when the earth starts shaking? I mean, come on, just last month we had how many earthquakes in Dallas? We have a lot of them, right? Almost 80. All these small, you know, shakes sometimes you have in your lunch and you have your cup of chai and start shaking in front of you and just like wondering what's going on, right? But what happens when it starts shaking really, when it starts really, really, really shaking? What does that exactly mean? Everything will be destroyed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِذَا رُجَّتِ الْأَرْضُ رَجَّى. And then when the earth is going to be basically going to be shaken, it's going to be smashed, and the jibal is going to start right now, you know, being destroyed, turn into specks of dust. So basically, that's just like giving you an idea when the earth starts shaking, what is the possible after event that will happen? That's left for you to imagine. If a small shake, basically, if two pieces of the earth plates, they snap, what do they cause, Jama'ah? If they snap, what do they cause? Huge earthquakes. And if this happens in the water, what's going to happen? Tsunamis. Now, that's a small snap, just a little snap. Imagine if this now is completely shaken. So when you say the rujjatul ardu rajja, I want you to imagine the violent shaking of the earth. That's what it means. So everything starts falling apart. That's what it means. يَوْمَ تَرْجُفُ الرَّاجِفَ. And Allah says, تَتْبَعُهَا الرَّادِفَ. Followed by الرَّادِفَ. الرَّادِفَ in the Arabic language, تَرْدِف, means that the thing that comes right after. The one or the thing that comes right after. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the angels, He says, Surah Al-Imran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Surah Al-Anfal, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, من الملائكة مردفين. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that He will send to them ملائكة مردفين. Means the angels will be following right away, 1,000 after the other. They will come following. So الرديف will always come after. So here we have two actually events. Number one, when the earth is shaken. And number one, that this number two is that the second right now event that comes after. What is that? The first one was summarizing the events of the Day of Judgment, the events of the end of this world. And the second one summarizes what? The beginning of the afterlife and the beginning basically of the resurrection event. So the first one speaks about the blowing of the trumpet, the first blow, which results in the shaking of the earth, destruction of the mountains and everything. And the second one would follow to bring everybody back again to life. Will succeed, will bring back everybody to life. Just these two words, as you can see, summarize whole big events. But it was left for you to imagine. When the earth shakes, you can imagine what happens on it. And when the command comes for the second blow, then what happens? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says right away, قُلُوبٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ wajifa. قُلُوبٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ wajifa. قُلُوب. What's قُلُوب, جماعه? Hearts. يَوْمَئِذٍ wajifa. The second, basically, that will result with that heart, some hearts, that they will shake with fear and anxiety. Okay. So here's a few things, subtle things about this ayah. Number one, the word qulub. In the English language, the translation said some hearts. But in the Arabic, actually, قلوب means lot of hearts. The قلوب means a lot. The lot of hearts. So which means what? Not all the hearts will be shaken. Why? Because some believers were promised what? Safety. Can you give me some categories of people who will be given safety on that day? Before the Anbiya. Besides the Anbiya. سَبْعَةٌ يَظُلُّهُمُ اللَّهُ بِظُلِّهِ يَوْمَ لَا ظُلَّ إِلَّا ظُلُّهُ The seven categories of people whom Allah will shade them under His shade, the shade of His throne, when there will be no shade but His subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's way before the account even starts. When everybody is shaken, they will be in peace, waiting for the account to begin and start. So, not all the hearts will be in that position. But here, since the context is speaking about threatening the people of Mecca who are not believing, then it's befitting, of course, to talk about these people in particular. قُلُوبٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ So a lot of hearts will be on that day wajifa in the Arabic language means in fear and in anxiety. So why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala referred the fear to the hearts? Why? That's what matters, right? Even in this life, when someone is afraid, where do you feel the heart? Where do you feel the fear, jama'ah? Do you feel the fear in your head or in your feet? Where do you feel it? So when someone wants to say he's brave or she's brave, where do they point? Do they point like this, I'm brave? Or do they say, I'm brave? What does that mean exactly? It means I have a strong heart, right? So when it comes to fear and anxiety and strength and power, it's there. You have it in your heart. So they say, SubhanAllah, I don't know how you do that, just but you have a very solid heart, mashallah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala referring to their fear that's going to be filling their hearts. And if someone's heart is full with fear and anxiety, can you imagine their condition right now? They'll start falling apart, basically. Psychologically, they're just completely now disturbed. And when you talk to them, are they going to even listen? No. No. They won't listen at all. And they don't pay attention. They're completely now, completely worried about themselves. They're just completely kind of out of that context, out of the contact with the surrounding world. Because they're so busy worrying about themselves right now. Also, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala referring to the word qulub, qulubun yawma'idin wajifa, on that day, there'll be a lot of hearts will be in fear and anxiety. Now that incident right now, is it happening before the resurrection or after the resurrection? Ya jama'ah, that's after the resurrection. What do you understand from saying referring to hearts? And afterwards there is absar, sight, when it's after the resurrection. What do you understand from this ayah? So, if this is happening after the resurrection, in regard to humans after the resurrection, what do you understand? How are they going to come out? How are they going to look like? What is it exactly? Besides that, physically? Restored. Is restored exactly, the soul or the bodies? Both the souls and the bodies, because some people they say the resurrection will only happen for the souls, not the bodies. But here, when the ayah, when Allah subhanahu is saying that hearts will be full with fear and anxiety, and the sides will also be khasha, looking down all the time, what does that exactly mean? The restoration is for the body and for the soul, not just for the soul. Because again, the reference is for hearts. How can you have hearts if there's nobody to carry it, right? How are you going to have sight if there's nobody also to carry the eyes that can function in that way, to have that sight? So the ayah referring to the resurrection of both the body and the soul. So indication to the people of Mecca, again, who deny the resurrection by body and soul, Allah says, you shall be resurrected, and your hearts will be full with fear and anxiety. Absaruha khashi'a. The eyes or their sights will be khashi'a. So the absar, first of all, absar, and then khashi'a. Let's talk about this a little bit. After speaking about the heart, why would Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say absaruha khashi'a? Absar, first of all. Sights, the sight. Why didn't Allah just speak about the hearing? Why the sight in particular? I mean, they could be, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could say, and their hearings will be silent, for example, will be attentive, will be just paying attention, whatever. Why the site was mentioned here in particular? Huh? So they could look around? But no one dares to look around at that moment. Be ashamed. What else? That's expressing anxiety. Uh-uh. Come on, guys. We've talked about it multiple times. The significance of the site, and we mentioned that last weekend. What is the significance of the site? Huh? Ayn al-yaqeen. Ayn al-yaqeen. The certainty of sight. Remember, there are certain categories for knowledge, right? The first category of knowledge is what? Ilm al-yaqeen. The certainty of knowledge. The certainty of knowledge. Certainty has different categories. So the first one is the certainty of knowledge. How do you get certainty of knowledge? If you get the news from a reliable source. If a friend of yours that is reliable to you tells you something and you trust this person, would you believe it or not? You would, right? Imagine if it's coming from a trustworthy source like the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this is now, of course, a reliable source. So you have ilm al-yaqeen, the certainty of knowledge. But then, is that enough? Some people, but they need something else. That something else might not necessarily increase their belief, but increase their what? Their tranquility and peace regarding the knowledge that they have. And that's when they require what? Seeing it. Like if someone tells you about an accident out there, you know, you believe the person right now. But then when you go out there, what happens? When you go and you see, that knowledge, that level of knowledge increases to a more certainty right now level. Musa alayhi salam, when he was meeting his Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala, before he left to his people, Allah azza wa jalla told him, Ya Musa, Allah gave him the tablets now. Musa got the tablets. Allah told him, Ya Musa, when you go back to your people already worship in the calf. You'll find them already worship in the calf. Even though Musa's meeting with Allah to get the commandments so he can deliver that to Bani Israel, Allah is already telling Musa, listen, they're worshiping the calf already, just to let you know. Meaning, so you don't be disappointed with them when you get back there, right? Now, Musa speaking to whom? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do you need even any more certainty of knowledge than this? No way. But when Musa went and he saw with his eyes, what did he do? He threw the tablets. He broke them. The certainty of Similarly, when Ibrahim alayhi salam, he had a debate with the Namrud, the king, and he said to him, Allah, he's the one who brings the dead back to life. So the Namrud, he said, I can do that too. Here you go. So he ordered one of the prisoners to be killed, another one to be free. He said, I give life and death. Now, Ibrahim could argue with this with him, right? But he didn't. But then later on, in the same surah afterward, two ayahs after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings a story between Ibrahim and Allah azza wa jal. Ibrahim asked Allah, قَالَ رَبِّ أَرِنِي كَيْفَ تُحْيِي الْمَوْتَى. Can you show me how you bring the dead back to life? Does it mean that Ibrahim had doubts about Allah's ability to bring the dead back to life? No. He knows for sure. But it's the certainty of sight that people they look for. Musa alayhi salam, after his people worshipped the calf, and they were ordered to punish them, those who worshipped the calf from those who didn't, then Musa, Allah called Musa to summon him to come with the leaders of Bani Israel, who are the best of the best right now, to come and meet with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So 70 of them went with Musa alayhi salam. Musa was communicating with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They don't hear that, but he is communicating on their behalf. Then when the conversation was over, the people of Bani Israel, the leaders now, telling Musa, we won't believe you until we see Allah azza wa jal. Like, seriously, what happened over here? We don't know. How we know that you were speaking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala immediately took their lives. Instantly. And Musa appeared to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Rab, these are my sufaha. Just, you know what? I'm going back to Bani Israel, tell them that I killed your leader. So Allah brought them back to life in front of their eyes. They're watching each other coming back to life. And Musa alayhi salam, then he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a question. Like these people ask Musa to show them Allah Azza wa Jal. Like, so you're not going to believe until we see Allah Azza wa Jal. Musa dared afterwards. He says, قَالَ رَبِّ أَرِنِي أَنْظُرَكَ. Can I see you now? They're gone. Can I see you now? Allah says, you can't see me. In this world, in this form of life, you cannot see me. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showed him the evidence. فَلَمَّا تَجَلَّ رَبُّهُ لِلْجَبَلْ جَعَلَهُ دَكَّ وَخَرَّ مُوسَى صَاعِقًا. When Allah just, the light of his majesty just was exposed to the mountain. The mountain was destroyed and Musa himself, he died. Allah brought him back again to life, alayhi salatu wassalam. So the point I'm making over here right now is that sometimes we need the certainty of sight. So here, the reason Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after speaking about the heart, he spoke about the sight. What was the reason for that? To speak about the second level, the next level of certainty. Absaruha khashi'a. The eyes that are used usually to collect that knowledge that raises your certainty, on that day, they don't even dare use them anymore. Because it is so certain, it is so absolutely convincing right now, you don't even have to look to believe. It's to that level. The certainty of the Day of Judgment. The certainty of you standing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is at that level that you don't even have to have a second thought or having a second look. Because it's so certain, you don't even need your eyes to believe anymore. That's what it means. أَبْصَارُهَا خَاشَعَ. These sights, as Allah says, looking downward, completely, you know, neglecting whatever, because that's it. I don't even need any more evidences to believe. That's what it means on the day of resurrection. Allah is warning these people, you will be at that level. يَقُولُونَ أَإِنَّا لَمَرْدُدُونَ فِي الْحَافِرَةِ. Quickly, inshallah, just going over these ayat. Now, suddenly, after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swears by the angels, and then showing them his ability to destroy this world and bring them back again to life, so they can see for themselves and live that and stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, suddenly the conversation in the ayat moves to completely different side. What is that side? يَقُولُونَ أَإِنَّا لَمَرْدُدُونَ فِي الْحَافِرَةِ. They say, shall we indeed be returned to our former state of life? يَقُولُونَ. Who's يَقُولُونَ? Who's those people who are saying? Who are they? The mushrikeen, the people of Mecca. So how come the conversation moves straight from Allah speaking to them about this to Allah immediately speaking about them now? This is just like mocking them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَقُولُونَ. This is like, seriously, look at what they say. Allah showed them all of this, and now he says, these people, still after all of this, they still would say, يَقُولُونَ أَإِنَّا لَمَرْدُونَ فِي الْحَمَةِ. Are we going to be returned back to this life? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is now telling them, after all of this, you still dare to say that we're going to be resurrected back again to this life? In the Arabic language, when you use the word, the fi'l mudara', which is the present tense verb, such as yaqulun, what does that exactly mean? It's constant, continuous. Means even after all of this, they still say, are we going to be returned back to this life? After all of this, after hearing about this, after knowing about all of this, they still dare to say, "Inna lamardudu," we're going to be returned to al-hafira. And this life was called al-hafira from the word al-hafir. Hafara yahfiru. Al-hafir means to dig something. Why is that? Why do we refer to the earth, to the life, as, you know, digging something? Because, you know, when you dig something, you leave traces in this world, on this earth. And when you live your life, what do? You leave traces of your life in this world. So al-hafira is reference to this life, like you're going to be returned back again to that same life that you left, you know, some traces, you know, there. What are the traces that you leave behind? That's your legacy. If it's good, you shall see it. If it's bad, you shall also see that. قَالُوا أَإِذَا كُنَّا And the ayah continues, أَإِذَا كُنَّا عِظَامًا نَخِرًا. Part of their now ridiculous arguments. Like, seriously? Even after we become عِظَامًا نَخِرًا. In the Arabic language, النَخِرًا, the bones, talking about after our bones become نَخِرًا. What's the meaning of نَخِرًا? It means actually hollow from the inside. And then نَخِر in the Arabic language, النَخِر, is the whistling sound, like whistling sound. So when there's a whistling sound, like even after our bones become so dry and empty from the inside, hollow, that, you know, when the wind blows, it's going to be whistling. Basically, even after we've been dead for so long, we're still going to be brought back again. They say to themselves, قَالُوا تِلْكَ إِذَنْ كَرَّةٌ خَاسِرَةٌ. You know what? If this is true, what you're saying, our return, it's going to really will be return with loss. But are they saying this in the form of remorse or a form of rejection and arrogance? Arrogance. They're not now showing remorse, saying, no, if this is true, we're going to be really in trouble. No, they're saying this out of arrogance. Like, you know, see, if this is right, what are you saying? We're going to really be in trouble. But they're doing it and they're saying it out of arrogance. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says afterwards, قالوا قال فإنما هي زجرة واحدة. He didn't answer them. Allah did not answer them because they don't deserve to be answered. But instead he gave us a statement. He said, قال سبحانه وتعالى فإنما هي زجرة واحدة. The letter فا in the Arabic language here, that means right after. It's so sudden that it's going to be a matter of one single zajra. The Arabic language zajra, a zajra in the Arabic language means when you yell at somebody. Like a big cry, a loud cry. Yelling, this is zajr in the Arabic language, the sound that I just made. So that is a reference to what? To the blow on the trumpet by the angel. Zajratun wahida. It's going to be one blast. That's what it means. One single blast. فَإِذَا هُمْ بِالسَّاهِرَةِ Well, behold, they're going to all be in a sahira, that place of congregation. Now, why would Allah refer to the blast as one single blast? What does it mean? That's what they're mocking. That's what they were ridiculing. Allah says, it's as easy as one blast for us. Allah says, it's going to happen. It's one single blast. It means it doesn't take much from us. Allah says, it doesn't take much from me, subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's one single blast, and you shall see, you're all going to be standing in this place. This place, which Allah called over here, As-Sahira, in the Arabic language, usually As-Sahira, is a flat land, flat surface of the land, that is very actually clear and clean, when people usually gather to for certain reasons, whether they want to have a meeting, distribute war spoils, whatever they do, so they don't want to have any obstruction in the land. They want it to be flat and be clear. So that's exactly how the earth is going to look like on the day of resurrection. Allah says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, about the mountains will be completely destroyed, and everything will be flat. And you don't, لا ترى فيها عوجا ولا أمتا. You won't see any kind of, you know, bending or mountains or hills, nothing at all. Everything is flat. That day, everybody's going to be on that same flat, same plane. Everybody is going to be there. So that's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warning the people of Mecca. Then, what comes next, which we're going to be discussing next week, inshallah ta'ala, an example from the people who were before. Allah says, هل أتاك حديث موسى? Did you hear about the story of Musa? Like you think that you're the only people who are going to be dealing with this? We dealt with people who were more mighty than you. Were stronger than you. And that's the Fir'aun, the Pharaoh of Egypt and his people. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned some of these details. We're going to discuss next week inshallah tabaraka wa ta'ala. So again, to go over the ayat real quick inshallah. A reminder inshallah what we discussed over here. Surah An-Nazi'at. An-Nazi'at here talks about the angels. As for the majority of the Mufassirin, some of the Mufassirin, they say it speaks about the planets and the stars. It speaks about maybe the warriors and the horses and so forth. But most of them, they say this is actually speaks about the angels. And Nazi'at, they pull the souls of the disbelievers forcefully, actively, and they just glide without any effort, you know, to do that. And they will always race to fulfill the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of this, Allah is swearing by this, for what? To prove that day is coming. You shall be resurrected. There will be a day, there will be a moment when the earth will be shaken, and you can imagine what happens out of the shaking of the earth, of all the events of the Day of Judgment, and then followed by that will be a radifa that brings everybody back to life. They will be coming back in body, by body and soul, because Allah said, قلوب, hearts and sights. And Allah said, these hearts are going to be very trembling, they're very, very, very afraid and in anxiety. Absaruha, and the reason the sight was mentioned with the, as of course, you know, after the hearts, because it indicates what? Another level of certainty. So even the sights, you're not going to need them anymore. Because it's so true, you don't have to have a second thought about this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then mocking these people who are saying that this is not going to happen. He says, it will happen, and it's a matter of one blast. We shall all be resurrected, standing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wallahu ta'ala alam. Any question, Jama? Yes.
No. The translation is saying it's referring to the opposite of the disbelievers who get theirs pulled out violently. So how have they derived like that?
Contrast. Because the ayat al always mathani. So if you speak about the believers, you're going to speak about disbelievers. If you speak about the souls of the disbelievers, speak about the souls of the believers. So that's one of the translations. Wallahu a'lam. Now, yes.
The fact seems like the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts it by spearing it, it seems like it's more of a scaring or like a fear tactic, which I feel like, I mean, how would that actually work out with the second ayah if it's supposed to be contrasting with the first ayah?
True, that's according to the meaning that he was referring to. There are other meanings as well. Some, for example, say an-nazi'ati gharqa doesn't mean actually the angels. It means that the warriors, when they stretch their archery, that's when they do the naz' gharqa. So some of the ulama of tafsir, they say this ayah was like speak about the future, because the ayat were revealed in Mecca, and the ayat here refers to a future event that will happen as a warning to the people of Mecca. Like saying, listen, there will be some sort of fighting. And there will be some sort of nashat and activity. And there will be horses running in the battlefield. So basically, even though the ayat were still revealed in Mecca, and when the Muslimin were very, very weak, they won't even imagine themselves fighting these believers. Or the believers, they won't even imagine themselves standing against these weak people in battlefield at all. Allah was indicating that this is going to happen in the future. So that's one tafsir of the ayat. Other tafsir speaks about the planets and the stars. As-sabihat, as-sabhat, gliding in the or in the universe. So there are different meanings for that. So one of these meanings is this, an-nashitati nashta, it's a contrast from the first one to be for the believers. Wallahu a'lam. Na'am. Yes. There were seven categories of people. The Prophet ﷺ, in one hadith, he said, سَبْعَةٌ يُضُلُّهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي ظُلِّهِ. There are seven people, seven categories of people who will be under the shade of Ar-Rahman when there will be no shade but His. Do you guys know them, the seven people? Let's count them together. Number one. The first one says a righteous leader. And that leadership in general, the major leadership. Second, he says, a man who's invited to commit the zina by a powerful, beautiful lady, but he says, إِنِّي أَخَافُ اللَّهِ, I fear Allah Azza wa Jal. So basically, someone who stands against temptation and says no. Number three, what else? Yes. The one who gives generously, that even he doesn't count how much he's given, that even his left hand doesn't even know how much his right hand is given. What else? Number four. A man whose heart is attached to the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every time he finishes the salah, he wants to come back to the masjid. Instead of running away, he wants to stay as much as possible in the masjid because his heart attached to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who else? Number five. A man who's crying in the secret, of course, a person, a man or woman. Crying secretly out of fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number six. The one who loves another person for the sake of Allah. Only for the sake of Allah. And the last category? On behalf of the youth committee, he's saying, is the youth who's growing up fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And out of love for Allah azza wa jal and fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is true. So eventually there are several categories. I hope may Allah subhanahu make you among those one categories, if not all the categories, you know, inshallah, ta'ala, to be safe on the day of judgment. Wallahu a'lam. Khair, inshallah ta'ala. Last question. Let's go ahead. Why don't you ask Sheikh Omar? Why are you asking me right now? You asked Sheikh Omar that question. All right. Inshallah ta'ala. Okay, so inshallah ta'ala, when we come next week, bidnillah, we will be talking about the second part of Surah An-Nazi'at, and that is the story of Musa and Fir'aun. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.